So it's a great pleasure to have Professor Leonardo Senatore from Institute for Theoretical Physics, Stanford University, California. I'm not giving a big introduction of Leonardo. People, those who are doing cosmology, people know him very well. He also got this New Horizon Prize in physics, and his background is a little bit different. He came from actually aerospace engineering, which is very interesting. And right now he's doing cosmology and physics, which is completely different to that. But yeah, like Leonardo is a very good researcher as well as a speaker. So he's going to talk about a very interesting topic in which he started doing work from the last year, probably. I have seen your one big paper on that. So from lambda 5^4 in D-sitter to how inflation starts out of inhomogeneous initial conditions. So Leonardo, you can start your talk, and we start recording. Okay.
Thank you. Okay. So thank you, Sayantan, for organizing this meeting in this busy time, in this complicated times. I hope everybody's fine. I'm happy to participate, and I will present the story of lambda 5^4 in the Fitte space. Now, if there is there will be additional time, I will also talk about another kind of a research line that I like, which is starting how to start inflation out of inhomogeneous initial condition, and how this offers a new connection between cosmology and mathematics. In the second, this would be the second part of the talk if there is time. In fact, let me start by explaining why it's interesting to study lambda 5^4 in the Fitte space. Massless lambda, of course, feel free to ask questions. So let's consider massless lambda 5^4 theory in the Fitte space. It is IR divergence. That is, because of that, we do not know how to make predictions. So why we should care about this? Well, at some level, this is somewhat embarrassing, because if one can think of the simplest scalar field theory that one can imagine, usually typically is massless lambda 5^4. Or at least a massive lambda 5^4, but for technical reason, massless smells to be a bit simpler. Then, in reality, a theory of a massless lambda 5^4 in the Fitte space could have also observational consequences, because imagine that there is a theory like this representing an additional scalar field during inflation, coupling for even to the inflaton, and then like in, for example, in quasi single field model, but now coupling a loop level like this. And in this case, we would not know how to make predictions, because...
Leonardo, sorry for the interruption. Here, sure, sure. Pi is the inflaton field you are considering, and what is the pi? Pi is some massive field or something?
No, let's call pi the inflaton, and phi this field, which is a spectator field in the inflation, another field with potential lambda 5^4. For example, let's consider this. Pi is the inflaton fluctuations, and we can see that these are, suppose this would induce a three-point function in inflationary fluctuations, but we wouldn't know how to compute them, because there is this, we don't know how to compute three-point functions of phi.
Okay.
In general, I'm trying to motivate this subject, because it is, as you will see, it's somewhat a technical study, and therefore it's good to have a good motivation, at least in my opinion. So another motivation to study this is that inflation is most probably, at least to many of us, the theory of the early universe. And therefore, we should be able to understand its consequences very well. In particular, its radiative correction, which are an intrinsic part, essential part of the theory, at least for the consistency. So even though they're small, we expect them to be small, we should prove that they're small. Now, for single field inflation, a few years ago, there was a debate if they were actually small. But I think if there is only 1 degree of freedom during inflation, I think we have a satisfactory understanding. When we study radiative loop quantum correction, radiative corrections, loop correction, these are all synonyms, roughly speaking, to the theory of inflation, if there is only 1 degree of freedom, we can ask what is the effect on the observable. These are the curvature fluctuation square. And at loop level, there will be IR UV divergences, which get normalized introducing logarithms of the normalization scale. And it's interesting to study what goes together with this in the log to make the argument of the log dimensionless. And it was shown that after carefully doing the calculation, the log goes like log H over mu, where H is the scale of the Hubble scale during inflation, which means that the log, there is no variation of diffeomorphism invariants if one performs the regularization carefully, which is non-trivial in the Sitter space. This is a theory of quantum gravity in the Sitter space. That's what the inflation is, in a space-time close to the Sitter space. So the log, however, doing things carefully, the log is small if the renormalization scale is chosen to be close to the Hubble scale during inflation, which is very intuitive because we always think in our mind that the energy scale of inflation is the fluctuations of inflation is the Hubble scale. And therefore, we expect the log to be small when we choose we define the theory at the scale. And that's what happens here. Then there could have been instead IR divergences. IR divergences come into two forms. One can be proportional to the time of the universe, the time since, for example, more across the horizon, all the on. Or logarithms proportional to the size of the universe. Now, the time, it could be shown that it all loops that this factor, the two-point function, the correlation function of zeta, a long times don't grow with time, okay? Don't behave like this in time. And this is very important for the predictions of inflation because it means that it's enough to make the computations up to the reheating time of inflation. Then from there on, everything is constant.
So Leonardo, so yes. Here H is almost constant or just constant?
Yeah, H in inflation, you're right. That's a good point. H is almost constant in inflation. And therefore, to so which value we choose? For each wave number, it should be chosen the value. I mean, this term is just zero, so it doesn't matter what we choose. But here, for example, we should choose the number of the Hubble, which is the Hubble rate at the time when a certain mode crossed, the given mode crossed the Hubble scale.
Sorry, can I ask a question? Which Cauchy surfaces do you start with? Are they compact or non-compact? And which initial state do you use?
Yeah, so we start from the FRW slicing of the Sitter space. So this calculation done just in the FRW slicing. Okay.
So if I take T to past infinity, does it go to, does it, the metric become singular or it becomes, I don't know, something else? Like in Poincaré region of the Sitter space, or
exactly. Yeah, yeah. The FRW slicing is the Poincaré patch. That's synonymous.
And, yes. Do you care that there are also similar sort of I wouldn't call it divergence. I would call it growth with time. The same sort of growth of higher point functions. I mean, mathless fields also like all point functions grow.
Yeah, that's what we're going to talk later. Okay, this is for single field inflation, they're not there. Okay, and so for the moment I'm talking about single field inflation, and instead for higher, when there is additional fields, they are there and they are worrisome. So if these terms are there, are worrisome. Now for single field inflation, they're not there. If there's only 1 degree of freedom, we were shown and we proved that it is not there, but...
is that at every loop order before the summation, any point function grows, not only two-point function.
For additional fields, yes.
No. For single field.
I disagree with this. I think if one does the calculation correctly, we found that this each diagram has a behavior like this, but then they all cancel.
No, no, but what I'm saying is that at every order of perturbation theory, before the summation, or every point, or like any point function grows. After the summation, I don't know. I didn't do the summation because I don't know how to do it for when there are multiple point functions growing like that. I know how to do that when two-point functions do, but when like three-point functions grow, I don't already know how to do resummation.
In Fourier space, a teacher order in perturbation theory, if there is only one degree of freedom, this is zero.
Okay, I disagree, okay.
Okay, I mean, this is a... Okay, it's been there for some time. Now,
yeah, but also like it's state dependent. Maybe
the state we choose, I'm not sure it's state dependent, but the state we choose is the Banach-Davis vacuum, which is damped oscillations of the field.
But it's a very specific, highly symmetric state.
Yeah, I think, this is the, we're assuming that the perturbations are in the vacuum when they start very, very short distances. I think this is a very natural state, but I agree with you, this result depends on the state, even though I think one can show that the state is an attractor. In fact, we will see later that for multifield, there is an analogous state, which is attractor. I think for this case, the Banach-Davis vacuum is an attractor. So I think, I'm not sure I
should worry
about it, but it's true, but it's true. Well, I'm not going to show the calculation for this, because this is a, this is just a review of all the results. So in single field inflation, I stress that we find that at each order, these are zero in Fourier space. Maybe the confusion is that because we're talking about Fourier space here. And in principle, there could be also logarithms of the wave number times the size of the universe. And these are really there, actually. And but one can show that they're absent upon defining physical observable, that is, this go away from when there is a one computes physical observables, and this object per se is not yet physical observable because it depends on the Fourier modes that are not these coordinates, which are Fourier modes in co-moving coordinates, are not directly observable. But as I mentioned before, for non-derivative coupled multifield, some of these terms are there, some of the divergences are there, and this will be the subject of the talk. But let me still open a new connection, why it's worth to study lambda fourth in the city space. It has to do with these IR divergences that are present in single field inflation, because they go away, they disappear when we compute physical observable. And in practice, this means that is physical observable? It is the amplitude of the fluctuations of inflation for a given physical observable scale. For example, the angle of our eyes, the angles that two fluctuations form in our eyes is a physical distance, but it's enough to define the amplitude of the fluctuations in terms of the volume, as a function of the volume that is covered by a certain wave number at the end of inflation. In this way, when one does this is the redefinition, the IR divergence disappears. Now, what is the how does this term looks in as a function of the original wave number in co-moving coordinates? Let's see what happens during inflation. During inflation, we have a blue mode that crosses the horizon during inflation and then is expands together with the spatial of the universe. However, while a certain region, for example, the blue wave number could be the size of this box, while this box expands in the universe, new fluctuations keep coming out of the horizon all the time. And at the time of reheating, the actual volume that is associated to this original length scaling co-moving coordinates is actually larger than what would be naively by this amount, that is, the volume associated to a certain wave number, if there were no classical fluctuation, would be e to the 3 times the number of refoldings since the mode crossed the horizon to the end of inflation in a Hubble in units of the Hubble constant. But then all the fluctuations that go in the meantime, that come out of the horizon in the meantime, actually enhance this expansion. And for normal inflation, this is a small amount. It is about 10 to the minus 10. from the fraction that we see in our in the sky for the most that we see around us, 10^10 the number of refoldings to the end of inflation. But these are, and so it's a small effect, but at least intellectually, or we can imagine what happens if we try to make this factor one. And in fact, there is an interesting physical regime where the fluctuations can become order one. You might remember that the size of the fluctuations in standard Schrödinger inflation for zeta goes like, zeta is the curvature variable, that is constant outside the horizon, is Hubble times delta phi over phi dot, where delta phi are the inflation fluctuations. And by making the potential flatter and flatter, we enhance these fluctuations. And at some point, when these fluctuations become order one, something we see that there is a big correction to the volume here, and we begin to lose the naive perturbative control. When this happens, in fact, something physical is happening. We're approaching a phase transition, which is called, we approach the regime of the well-known Schrödinger eternal inflation. That is, as we make the potential flatter and flatter, the amount of volume, imagine that you start every time the unit with a certain fixed volume, you ask what is the volume at the end of inflation produced by this inflationary, which is the volume of the box at the end of inflation. And if the fluctuations are small, this is always the same plus a small enhancement due to the quantum fluctuation. So the surface of reheating of the as a function of x is slightly curved in time because there are fluctuations, but the overall volume is quite the same as in classical physics. But as we make the fluctuation zeta larger and larger, as they approach one, there are big fluctuations in the duration of inflation each point because the field jumps back and forward in this trajectory a lot of time. And actually it's possible to show that with a precise number, when zeta is of order one, but with the pi's and everything, actually there is a phase transition, and there is a, it begins to be a, for flatter potential, flatter than a certain threshold, they begin to be a finite probability to for the volume of the heating surface to become infinite. So this is the onset of the eternal inflation regime. It's a phenomenon where quantum effects change completely the asymptotic space-time. The space-time changes from being quite deterministic to be highly the asymptotic regime is completely changed by quantum effects, but it's also the space-time becomes stochastic. And so one should talk about statistical property of the space-time rather than simple geometric objects. And this is interesting because it's a quantum effect that changes the asymptotic space-time and makes it become statistic. It's probably the largest quantum effect one can imagine. It's, in a sense, it's more radical than what happens in black hole evaporation, because the black hole evaporation changes the asymptotic of the space-time but keeps the space-time sort of semi-classical, in the sense that at each time there is a well-defined value of the geometric quantities. Here, instead, the space-time becomes much stochastic. And this the phenomenon was discovered in the 80s by Starobinsky, Linde, Vilenkin, these people. But I think in the last few years, we were able to provide a rigorous definition, a rigorous understanding. For example, the probability distribution of the volume in this regime has some probability, and the integral of this probability is less than one because there is a delta function at infinity. And when the volume is finite, the probability is peaked around some point, and this point is quite different as we approach eternal inflation from the classical value. It is boosted by a factor of two. So this is, I think, a very fascinating topic. But it has a caveat, because the initial discovery and also the quantitative understanding of eternal inflation that I just presented in this slide, were based on the
so-called... Leonardo, can you speak about this stochastic properties a bit more? Why this is so important and what exactly we need to care about here?
You mean about this? About this or about what I said before?
Could you please clarify about the limits of applicability of this stochastic approach?
Yeah, I mean, okay, the stochastic approach, I will, okay, so I think there are two questions by stochastic. First was the fact that why we care on the stochasticity of the space-time. Now, the question is relevant because observationally, this is very small effect, okay? In practice, in our units, we see a very, very small region of this rating surface. And if we ask all conditional probabilities, that is, what are the fluctuations given that the universe was in this condition, given that we have some long mode that came out of the horizon this time, say the longest mode in our universe, then one can forget about all of this. This is all on some distances longer than what we observe. So the statistical these fluctuations are very small once we impose that there was a mode that came out of the horizon with some property 60-folding before us. This is the mode that defines the current background temperature in our universe. So that means that all what we observe is somewhat locally defined, and therefore it's not observation relevant. However, it's relevant theoretically. First of all, I find it that is an incredibly interesting solution of general relativity plus quantum mechanics. I think it's even more interesting than the black hole evaporation because the effect are even more wild. Not only something, the black hole evaporation, something is there and then it's no more there. But here, the space-time, but the way the evaporation proceeds is kind of semi-classical. And so there's always a black hole there, which is getting smaller. Instead, in this universe is completely stochastic, okay? There is, so one has completely changed framework. It's like having a semi-classical wave function and instead a quantum wave function. And also, I find it interesting because of course there are many interesting aspects about the de Sitter entropy, similar to the black hole entropy. And for example, the maximum volume that can be produced by this inflationary phase when it is finite, that is, it can be infinite, but if it is finite, is never bigger in practical terms than the exponential of the de Sitter entropy over two. I find this fact that might teach us something about the Sitter space, and I think it's interesting. So I think I was trying to answer the question about Sayanda. Now, the question of Emil, it will be the part of the talk. I mean, I'm going to explain now. So please ask again if I'm not answering. Okay, so as I was mentioning, this Sayanda, let me know if I didn't answer your question, please. So, so all these results about eternal inflation were discovered initially, and also our quantitative understanding is based on the stochastic approach that was proposed and developed by Starobinsky. The stochastic approach of the quantum fluctuation is the following. According to this approach, the probability distribution of the quantum fluctuations of the scalar field zeroes down the potential at a given position x satisfy a Fokker-Planck-Lanck equation. The time derivative of the evolution of the fluctuation is equal to the sum of the diffusion term plus a drift term proportional to the slope of the potential. Now, as this equation is at the base of this, I think, very, to me at least, fascinating solution of general relativity with quantum mechanics, but as you will see in the rest of the talk, the same equation is able to solve also the issues of lambda factor the fourth in the Sitter space, non-perturbative, that is, which it was in ordinary perturbation theory.
Leonardo, so in actual Fokker-Planck version, so the drift and diffusion term, they are actually connected because one of the term contains 2n, another one of the term contains n into n plus 1. So it's kind of that, but here it is different. The difference, why this difference is coming, this h square and v dash, it's coming from the equation of motion or something like that?
Yeah. The diffusion term intuitively comes because as the universe expands, I was going to explain this, but as the universe expands, new modes becomes the field flutters because the modes come out of the horizon, they give kicks to the inflaton. Mm-hmm. And this drift comes because there is a sort of a constant force towards moving the field towards a lower value by the slope of the potential. But maybe your question Okay, so this is the intuitive, roughly, very rough intuitive physics, but I think it's, why we work on this is because I think this equation lacked a satisfactory derivation or an understanding if this equation was a toy model or the leading expression in something.
So which why I'm asking, because in slow roll case, you actually write down your V dash as H squared.
V prime as H square, you say yeah. V dash. What is V dash? Sorry, what is V
dash?
V dash
is the V prime, yeah. V prime is H square in slow roll case.
No, I mean, V prime is units of mass cube, so it cannot be H square.
I'm saying that the rho by MP square is basically H square. So rho is of the order of, this is V prime.
Okay. Yeah, good. Thank you. Yeah, please ask this question because there will be lots of equations, so it's good that we go over them. Thank you. Okay, so this is the equation, but I think it lacked the satisfactory derivation. That is an understanding if this was a toy model or the leading expression of a correct equation in something, which something was to be specified. And if it is a special, if it can be made more precise, it can be made a systematic approach. In fact, for motivation, the Sitter space is still our current space-time, and behavioral quantum fields in it is very complicated, lambda for the four is higher divergence, and many people is worried by various forms of instabilities for different reasons, and I will not address, for example, Dual is worried by some instabilities which are not addressed in this talk, but for example, the ones of Polyakov, I think, are the ones that we're gonna address here. And in general, as I mentioned before, it's always interesting to study the Sitter space because gravity, infrared property of the Sitter space, because gravity is always very interesting in the infrared. Black hole evaporation, information loss or recovery, and the Sitter entropy are typical examples which are quite still confusing in the infrared. So let me summarize the introduction by saying that we're gonna do the following study because massless lambda for the fourth in the Sitter space and also slow inflation are non-perturbative phenomena. The system is non-perturbative. Lambda factor 4 is higher divergence, slow rotation inflation has huge quantum fluctuations that change the solution by order one. This stochastic equation might provide a way to solve for them, but lacks a systematic derivation and the proof of its accuracy. And in fact, we will prove that in this talk, that the equation is the leading order truncation of a generalized equation, from which we can derive arbitrary accurate results. This, in a sense, proves the existence of slow rotation inflation, it fills this missing gap, and also allows us to compute lambda factor fourth in the Sitter space. And by the Sitter space, I always mean in this talk, rigid Sitter space. That is, we are neglecting the gravitational fluctuations. Of course, it depends on your tastes and your physical taste is about the value of these results, because it depends how much you already believed in the stochastic approach. If you were satisfied with intuition associated with this equation, people might not find these results very interesting. But if one wanted to understand how to compute the sublimating correction in something to be specified, then this is interesting. Okay, and now we're ready to start.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Polyakov usually brings up the Schwinger effects as an analogy with the Sitter space, so these infrared effects and so on. Do you have any picture of why
are
under control in the Sitter but not under control in the electric field case?
So I think these analogies are always a bit tricky because the analogies are one should be careful with analysis because I think the correct, the best analogy is the one that is in the same universality class of the system that we describe. And otherwise it will have differences if it's not the same. So in particular here, I think in the Sitter space, I think it's true that the theory will go non-perturbative. So it's true that the Banach-Davis vacuum, the free theory Banach-Davis vacuum is unstable. Okay, so that's true. And so in a sense, Polyakov is right. What we will find is that there is a new state, which is non-perturbative different from the Banach-Davis vacuum. And we still call it Bunch Davis because it has some property with Bunch Davis, but it's a very interacting Bunch Davis vacuum. And which is the sitter invariant and for which the fluctuations are stable. So, and the reason why there is not a big back reaction is because, okay, so this is the answer. Now, the intuitive reason why there is no catastrophic regime is because basically it's very hard to accumulate things in the sitter space, maybe things spread, and that's why there is no, contrary to. And there is a spreading of things, but also replenishing of things from things coming out of the horizon. And I think that's the difference with the Schwinger effect.
I think you are starting from a very specific state, and that's the reason you find yourself in a safe place. And if you will start from a quite different, like excitation of the state, like added density of particles, and take into account multiple point functions, you'll find disastrous effects. Well, I mean, that's my point.
Okay, we will see. I will, the state that we will consider, will show, if there is time, that it's an attractor over a wide family of states.
Well, in Schwinger, in the case of constant electric field, also there is a time reversal invariant state for which, for example, the tree-level current is zero. So in that sense, you may say that this constant electric field doesn't decay. But like if you consider a bit different state, the current is not zero and there are other effects.
Yes, I mean, I'm gonna study the state that are in some sense close to the state I will consider. You will see, but I think the state is very reasonable in the sense that as the Bunch Davis vacuum is reasonable. But I agree with you on this, we can argue because what is the reasonable state is a matter at some level of, it's not a very well-defined question in physics.
But also like the situation, for example, in global decider is quite different than in Poincaré patch.
Yes, but I think to me, I am a cosmologist. I think this is the most interesting physical.
Yeah, but who knows? Yes. Maybe we have started from a compact universe.
Contracted, yeah, but the problem is a
compact. Contracted, compact sections, and it started to grow. Like the slices, Cauchy slices were compact rather than non-compact. Nobody knows what was the initial state.
Yes, but I think maybe you will see this in the second part of the talk. I don't think I will get there, but if I get there, you will see that actually, there is a comp. It's not globally well-defined, it's not really the sitter space, but it's very easy for compact universes that start expanding to develop patches, arbitrary large patches that look like the sitter space in the Poincaré patch, But I think, I don't have any very strong objection to what you say in the sense that any question about the initial state of the universe is a bit ill-defined at some level. So it's hard to have a very definite answer there. Because in physics we study the dynamics, not much the theory of the initial states. Okay, let us start. So for now we will focus on lambda factor of the sitter space. And let me explain the origin in a simple intuitive way, the origin of desired divergences. And the intuition can be understood by considering in the sitter universe. So for now we just focus on the sitter space. And let's consider the two-point function of a massless field. It is the two-point function in Fourier space goes like the Hankel function square. Okay, this with this index here. Now, imagine that the mass is very small, and therefore it's very natural to Taylor expand in the smallness of this mass here. And then one sees that the correction proportional to the mass actually grows with time because the scale factor is exponential. So it's quite clear that when the argument of the logarithm becomes exponentially small, lower than this, then this Taylor expansion breaks down. Now here, nothing tragic happens because we know the fully non-perturbative solutions. We know that the system actually, the fluctuations actually decay. But the fact that the leading effect in M, if we were to expand in the mass, is divergent, is actually the result we would obtain if we were to try to solve for the fact of the mass perturbatively. That is, if you consider, for example, imagine that you want to solve the Klein-Gordon equation of the scalar field in the Zeta space, neglecting the mass. So first we solve without mass, and we find that outside the horizon, the field is constant. Then we solve a first order, and outside the horizon, we can neglect these terms. And the first order solution is, we can plug here the zero order solution, and the first order solution is just, by this differential equation, the integral of the mass times the zero order solution. But a massless field in the Zeta space, outside the horizon is constant, so this is a constant, and so one obtains that this integral is just a factor of t. So this t is this t here, so we obtain the same IR divergence that maybe appears here. So we see that the perturbation theory will be in the mass, for the free theory will be IR divergence. Now, the same situation happens now in lambda phi to the fourth, because again, imagine when we do perturbation theory, we solve perturbatively around the theory around the expanding around the free theory. So first we solve the equation of motion for the free field, which is massless, so outside the horizon is constant. And then we want to compute the effect, the perturbation due to the nonlinear term. So we solve this equation, neglecting outside the horizon, we're interested in late time. So we focus on when the number is outside the horizon. And one sees that the equation is phi dot equal lambda phi cube. And so the solution to this is, here we put the zero order solution. And so the solution is the integral of the cube of the zero order solution times lambda. Now, if you imagine to compute correlation functions and effect proportional to lambda, it's quite intuitive that at some point we will need to compute expectation values of these. We'll take the expectation value, but since all these fields are constant in time, then the integral will give you a constant. A constant times the time. So the integral will be IR divergence, because at zero order, the fluctuations are time independent outside the horizon, or the expectation value is time dependent. So, namely, here you see that this IR divergence, but in this expression, it looks like that maybe this effect is just a mass, an effective mass that is generated by the fluctuation. And it's not like this. Diagrammatically, for example, one can consider always the contribution to the two-point function of the field, contribution proportional to the square of this field, where each leg on one side is contracted with the leg from the other side, okay? All the legs from left to right. Diagrammatically, this can be represented as this diagram. Here, crosses are correlation functions, and lines without crosses are Green's function, which for the theory outside the horizon is simply a time integral, the Green's function. I mean, the Green's function is one. Outside the horizon. So you see that this term, this is this diagram, while the former diagram was the two legs on the same side contracted and one leg contracted on the other side and then one Green's functions. So this diagram is clearly not, doesn't at least to Mars didn't have any particular mean field theory expression. In fact, we are not finding results that seems to be associated with any mean field theory later on. Okay, this is just to gain some intuition with our hands, but if one performs the standard in calculation for correlation function, this has been done by many people, Pollack, but also Burge, Cliff Burge, others, they indeed find rigorously the behavior I just sketched above. So it is, okay, it is true that there are these IR divergences. What is even more intuitive, what's happening? As a mode crosses the horizon and is stretched by the expansion of the universe, new fluctuations keep coming outside of the horizon, keep coming outside the horizon. So every time there is a fluctuation outside the horizon, the field jumps, and then we like to keep jumping. So in general, we like to explore all the region of free space if there was no potential. But the potential will at some point will impose some force letting the field come back. So the effect of the potential, and we stop the exploration of the field to arbitrary large values of the potential of the moduli space. And therefore this means that there is an order one correction to the solution. And the moment there is an order one correction to the free theory solution means that the solution is non-perturbative. And so we expect a non-perturbative solution. We can gain some intuition what this non-perturbative solution should be, because the jumps wants to make the field explore, but the classical drift wants to keep it here. So we expect a sort of equilibrium configuration. And this equilibrium configuration, what size should have? The energy of the system, we expect, as we already saw for the logarithm in the beginning, is of order h. Therefore, we expect all the values of the field with energy of order, such that the potential energy of order h to the fourth to be populated. So we expect the typical size of the field to be h over lambda to the 1/4. Notice that this is indeed a non-perturbative expression, because there is lambda to the this rational power, and this cannot be obtained in perturbation theory. And the question is how we can obtain a rigorous calculations of this new equilibrium state, whatever it is, if it exists, with arbitrary precision. Now, a common approach to this, a common law at least, is that upon performing the Euclidean rotation, the Sitter space is a sphere. The Poincaré patch of the Sitter space is a sphere, and so there are no IR divergences. Now, it's true there are no IR divergences in Euclidean space. And in fact, the zero mode of lambda factor to the fourth is the one which is non-perturbative in Euclidean space. And so people can solve, in some sense, the correlation function in Euclidean space. But when one rotates back the correlation functions to Lorentzian space, they become secularly divergent again, okay? So these divergences come back. And this has been very clearly emphasized and described in these papers. So as far as I know, there is no known solution yet for Euclidean space, but because some works additional manipulations are needed to find a consistent answer, but surely this research direction has made progress and it should be pursued. Probably there is a solution also in Euclidean space. But here instead, I will work always in Lorentzian space. And we are gonna define in this talk a rigorous formalism to solve the problem of lambda to the fourth.
Can I comment about the Euclidean? You see, when you do analytically continue from the sphere to the Sitter space Poincaré patch, you do the continuation in the geodesic distance. And that is specific only for those states for which correlation functions are functions of geodesic distances. But if you, for example, consider an arbitrary state, which like, for example, an excitation, even respecting Hadamard behavior of a Bunch-Davis state, then the correlation functions are not functions of geodesic distance. And analytical continuation from the sphere doesn't work. So I think you should always work in Minkowskian signature to keep control of everything.
Okay. Sounds good to me. I will work in Lorentzian space, but many people like it. So I take your point. Thank you. Okay, so you will be happy that we work in Lorentzian space. yes, that's a good point, though. I agree with what you say, in a sense. So we're going to define, now working in Lorentzian space, we're going to define a rigorous formalism that solves this problem, that zero order in all the expansion parameters that we will identify and introduce, because there is no expansion parameter currently known. But at zero order in everything, it reduces to the remarkable stochastic approach of Starobinsky. How we will achieve this? We will use two crucial simplifications around which we will expand. And this allows us to solve, notice this is a non-perturbative quantum problem in a Carl space-time. Now, this Carl space-time is still rigid, so it's a bit slightly simpler than the most general Carl space-time, but it's still quite non-trivial, at least for in my humble standards. Okay. So, what are the two simplifications that we're gonna use? There are two helps technically that comes from being in this. There's one help that comes from technically being in the Sitter space, is the fact that the Sitter space has an horizon, and when the modes are longer than the horizons, the gradients are negligible. And therefore we can expand around an exactly locally space evolution. Okay, the most different Hubble patches don't talk to each other, evolve independently, and this simplifies the dynamics. And then we will use another simplification that we will work a weak coupling. In reality, you will see that our coupling is actually the square root of the coupling constant, but is also we're very sure that this is smaller than one. Okay, what is the main idea? The main idea is the following. We will separate the theory into short and long mode. We do this by introducing an artificial cutoff at an energy scale epsilon h, where epsilon is much smaller than one, so that epsilon h is an energy scale much smaller than the Hubble scale. In commoving coordinate, scale can be also thought about the length scale, and in commoving is a physical length scale, and in commoving coordinate, this represents a time-dependent length scale. The time-dependent length scale is called lambda of t, and is epsilon h times the scale factor. I mean, there is a commoving wave number, which is one of the inverse of the commoving length, and the commoving wave number is epsilon a t. So this is time-dependent, this commoving wave number, because physical wave numbers start in the universe at short distances, in the Bunch Davis vacuum, we will assume, or in some mathematical sense close to this, and then they will expand, and then at some point will cross this threshold and become long. So at early times, a given mode is inside the theory of the short modes, and at late time is inside the theory of the long mode. Now we will treat very differently the long and short modes. For short modes, since these short modes become long after some time, the short modes live, each short mode live in the short theory only for some short time. The amount of time is actually log epsilon in Hubble times. So if we assure that we choose epsilon sufficiently large, so that lambda log epsilon less than one, then we can solve for correlation function of the short modes using the ordinary perturbation theory in powers of lambda. There is no, because this perturbation theory will be in powers of lambda log epsilon, which is much less than one, and so is well defined. Instead, we have to make the treatment of the long modes needs to be very different. And here we will use the exp of the expansion parameter 1 and 2, which is the locality and the weak coupling. The locality means that this epsilon here is much less than 1, and the weak coupling means that lambda is much less than 1. Okay, to simplify a bit the discussion, we can notice that the parameter, in order to make the theory of the short modes well defined, we need epsilon to be sufficiently large. But by sufficient large means larger than an exponentially small number in 1 over square root of lambda. It needs to be larger than this, a very, very exponentially small number. And the size of the gradient corrections, for example, the correction to the localities, the exact local evolution in space, are proportional to, some of them are proportional to this parameter epsilon. And this parameter epsilon, therefore, can be naturally chosen to be much, much smaller than square root of lambda, because it can go all the way to close to Hughes point. So the correction square root of lambda are generically much larger than the ones proportional to epsilon, which is associated to the splitting of these two the modes. And therefore, in the talk, I will not focus on this, even though they are included in the formalism, and one can compute the corrections in these terms if one wants. Okay. What is the object we want to compute? We want to compute correlation function of phi in the city space, this object, phi of x1, phi of xn. Following our nose, this is given by the path integral of, since we are doing in correlation function, the path integral of the fields phi of x1, phi of xn, times psi star of phi, psi of phi, which are the wave function of the states. But psi star phi, psi of phi, is the density matrix of the field. So this is the path integral over the density matrix. And here the square bracket means that this is a functional density matrix of the fields at a given time. Now, at least in principle, formally, this means that the correlation function here is given by this path integral. At least formally, one could do the path integral over all the points that are not appearing in the fields at which we evaluate the correlation function. And this would allow, that is, we can take this Parfinte, and this would reduce the Parfinte to these n ordinary integrals of rho bar of phi 1 phi n times phi 1 phi n, where rho bar of phi 1 phi n is the density matrix after integrating out all the locations where there are no fields minus the location 1 at n, at x1 at xn, where the field is chosen to have value phi 1 phi n. So this is the rho bar. Now, in Minkowski space, one could formally do this, but it's never been very useful because, but in general, this Parfinte integral is always hard. In fact, we will not do this Parfinte integral explicitly even as, but we will focus on this object. While in Minkowski space, this object, I'm not aware of any useful application, because the dynamics of this object is very will be very non-local because different points in Minkowski space talk to each other. So to solve for this point, naively, one needs the other points. To solve for rho bar at these points, one needs also the other points, and one integrates out, one gets non-locality. Instead, in the sintered space, in some sense, a long wavelength, modes don't talk to each other, points don't talk to each other, it's tempting to study this object, which is what we're gonna do this. But instead of doing the Parfinte integral, we will study the evolution, we'll find an evolution equation for the density matrix of the fields phi one of the fields phi one phi n. Okay, so let's try to solve for the density for the field density. Let us start. So this is where we'll end up with, but we have to start from the beginning, and the beginning is the equation of motion for the density matrix of the fields. This satisfies the following equation: the time derivative of the density matrix satisfy the following equation. This is in field space, this is nothing but the divergence, sum over all variables, x, phi of x is just all the variables of the fields, is the divergence of this, is called in quantum mechanics probability current. This is very common it's a reminiscent, if you open the Landau book, for example, we found this in quantum mechanics. Here, field theory is nothing but quantum mechanics with many variables. And this takes the name of the density current. Now, this is a complicated equation. To solve this functional, it's a functional equation and not even close. But it's not close because there is also the wave function here. So it's rho bar in terms of the wave function. But we are gonna try to close it because we're gonna see that in some sense, we can compute the wave function for lambda factor to the fourth. And this will allow us to manipulate this expression in a consistent way, in such a way that we can obtain an equation that can be solved for rho bar. Okay, so now I'm gonna open like a small parenthesis and try to compute for lambda phi to the fourth the wave function. And some relevant literature has already emphasized how to compute the wave function. For example, there are recent paper by Kanemed et al. That developed much farther the study, but do many more things, but lambda phi to the fourth perturbatively, there was a very nice paper in the city space by these authors that basically does the job.
So this and is here, Leonardo, this is the Euclidean wave function, this Hart-Locking type of?
No. This is but thank you for this question. No, this is simply the wave function. Here there is no metric, so okay. I'm going to work in rigid city space, okay? This is the limit of M Planck goes to infinity, the cosmological goes to infinity, the cosmological constant goes to infinity, Hubble constant. So this is the limit will work. And this is the simply the wave function of the distribution of the field, okay? It's like, for example, for an harmonic oscillator, this will be, the ground state will be e to the minus x squared. If you have two oscillators, this will be e to the minus x1 squared, e to the minus x2 squared. And here there are many, many fields, okay? It's the wave function of the fields of the field.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Since I don't see you in video, let me know if I am. Please tell me if I don't answer your question. Thank you.
Okay, sorry, Leonardo, another question. Your strategy seems to be that you're gonna solve that equation for the time evolution of the density matrix, right? But then you say that you can compute the wave function, but if I have the wave function, why can't I just, compute psi psi bar They have the density matrix.
Yes, I mean, because it's fine, but what we want, sorry, but what we want to compute, yes, that's I agree with you, you have, but you want to compute the evolution equation for the density matrix only a few locations. I mean, the density matrix per se is not that useful, it's complicated to use, okay, because...
It's that density matrix with marked points that you defined earlier.
It's a functional density matrix, and then there is a, to go from there to the correlation function, there is a functional integral to do, and that's hard. So there is an intermediate step which we're gonna solve the density matrix only over a few points. Okay, so it's a function of n variables.
Okay.
So, yes. So at least this is a path, the path we took. Okay. So now, let me show you. Yeah. So let's. That's the answer, Guillermo. This is the answer that the functional form is not very useful, at least in my opinion. Now, let's start for the wave function. The wave function satisfies a Schrödinger equation where the Hamiltonian is this is the momentum on the fields, and this depends on phi because there is the potential lambda phi to the fourth. Now, as usual in quantum mechanics, as we learn in quantum mechanics, and as a field theory is nothing but quantum mechanics with many, many variables, many degrees of freedom, the solution to this equation is nothing but a path integral of e to the I times the action. And the choice of the boundary condition of the path integral specify what is the vacuum, and we will choose the Banach-Davis vacuum. The Banach-Davis vacuum, at least in the first part of the talk, then we'll have a slight generalization. The Banach-Davis vacuum is chosen so that the fluctuations in the past oscillate as in Minkowski space, and we perform a rotation so that they are damped, so this represents the interacting vacuum of the theory at short distances. Notice that at short distances, the theory is perturbative, so that's well defined. There is no problem in the short fluctuation, so this vacuum is okay. That is, all the issues of the theories are at long distances. Now, it's actually quite beautiful, the perturbative structure. This path integral can be computed as we do in normal particle field theory, doing a perturbation theories. It is perturbative, it can be computed. And the story is quite nice for the path integral associated to the wave function. Normally in particle physics, we do path integral for the S matrix. And this is, but people in the DSFT often do this kind of path integrals. And this is interesting because the boundary conditions are different, in particular because this is a path integral with fixed boundary conditions at some time eta, given the wave function here. And therefore, the propagator, the Feynman diagram takes the form that if one can compute the n legs contribution to the exponent of phi, one computes a connected diagram where there are n points on a time slice eta, and these n points are connected to the bulk, we call this the bulk, by bulk to boundary propagators, and then all the legs inside the bulk are connected either by vertices or by bulk to bulk legs. Now the bulk to bulk legs have one propagator, it's called the bulk to bulk propagator, and the bulk to boundary propagators are called bulk to boundary propagator. They're called what in cosmology we call the transfer function. Is how the field evolves from one time to another freely. Now the inspection of this propagator is actually very nice because these are nothing but Green's functions, but they must satisfy the boundary conditions imposed by the solution to this path integral, and there's such a way that both the propagator for k goes to zero, there are no IR divergences, okay? This is a crucial difference with respect to what we know when we do correlation functions directly in the ordinary formalism, because one of the two propagators has a 1/kq behavior. And that's the origin of both of the IR and the secular divergences in an ordinary approach. Instead here, this propagator don't have an IR divergence. They're very smooth in the IR.
Leonardo, one more question. So when you are talking about this bulk boundary, so are you thinking to do the calculation by doing some Euclidean rotation in the time, like some you want to do some kind of DSCFT to a DSCFT type of thing?
No, there's nothing so sophisticated. I mean, here, okay, so maybe in practice it reduces to that in practice, but in fact, and this was actually the point of the people.
Why I'm saying, because the few people like Sandeep and all, they used to calculate like this way.
Yes, it's okay. That's true. I will not use the language. I think not to add another concept to the talk. But you're right. These are nothing but the final rules of these are upon a rotation are the ones of the partition function in EDS. Okay. Yeah. In fact, in that context, these are called Witten diagrams. Okay. These are called the Witten propagator. The structure is very different. Instead, in fact, so for example, for the free theory, the wave function is a Gaussian, and the late time goes like this. There is a real part whose exponent is k cube, and in fact, if one computes correlation function at this, only using this wave function, only the real part contributes, and one obtains two-point function, which are 1 over k cube. This is the famous scale invariant signal of a massless free theory. Notice there is also a phase. The wave function is a phase that doesn't contribute to correlation functions of phi, but this phase is k squared over eta. And so a very late time, as eta goes to 0, eta is the conformal time, and goes to 0 in the Poincaré patch late times, then the phase is very, very big. One can see that therefore this wave function is the wave function like for a given Fourier mode when k eta is less than 1 is the wave function of a very classical state. This is we can see in our eyes directly why in inflation or in the city space long wavelength fluctuations are semi-classical. This was pointed out in a famous paper by Guten P. Now at the interaction level we want to compute some corrections. We will compute the wave function perturbatively. And we will see that actually we can compute it perturbatively. And so a leading order in lambda, there is a contribution to the exponent with 4 phi's. And it goes like this. If I look at the log of the wave function, look at the exponent, there are, we sum over all the momenta with delta function momentum conservation, these are the 4 phi's, phi k1, k2, k3, and k4. And the late time and the correction goes like this. This is the it's called Witten diagram. So let's call it Witten diagram by analogy. And you see that there is a lambda, and there is a phase, an imaginary part that goes like 1 over eta cube. And there is a real part that starts in k cube, and it has a log. Okay, so two things I would like to notice. First of all, is that the law, there is no IR divergence. There is no log of the size of the universe. This was because there was this very good behavior of the propagators for k goes to 0. But there is this the logarithmic in times, which are for normally we call both IR divergences when either there is the size of the universe or the time of the universe. But here, for simplicity, to be specific, let me distinguish them, and these are called secular divergences. So you can see that there are secular divergences. But notice that the real part is much suppressed with respect at late time with respect to the phase. And in particular, therefore, if I compute the momentum operator, which is the derivative, and I apply the momentum operator to this Bunch-Davis wave function, I simply take the leading term is this one, and obtain a late time because this wins. And so I obtain lambda phi cube over 3h applied to the wave function. And notice that this is nothing but the classical value of the momentum of a field, the value of phi dot of times a cube times a cube, the value of phi dot for a field slow rolling in inflation in lambda phi to the fourth potential with a certain value of phi. That is phi dot, if you have a certain value of phi in the slow roll solution, is lambda phi cube over 3h. So we see that the momentum takes exactly this value, which is a nice consistency check. Indeed, the wave function we know is semi-classical, which is okay. Now, as I mentioned, there are no IR divergences here, but how come before we had in the normal perturbation theory there were IR divergences? Well, because if one, indeed they come back, if one tries to use this wave function to compute correlation functions perturbatively, phi phi goes like 1/k³ here, because perturbatively the real part of phi phi goes like k³, only the real part enters in, or the wave function enters in this part, and the 1/k³ here integrating d3k will give us the IR divergence. So everything is consistent, that the correlation function, which was observable, will be the same as before. But here, the wave function has some intermediate properties that instead we will use. In fact, by inspection of all the diagrams, it is possible to prove that for a generic diagram, the real part of the wave function, the imaginary part differs. That is, the imaginary part of the exponent of the wave function has some powers of lambda, some powers of phi, but in each of these powers there is always 1/(eta³) plus smaller terms in k eta, and the real part instead doesn't have the 1/(eta³), it has the k³, and then it has several logs. Other each loop goes like lambda log to the L, and there are some secular logs. So it's possible to
Sorry, Leonardo, I just realized that I didn't make my point clear about multiple point function grows. You see, if you look at this rightmost upper angle formula, it's a three-level propagator and leads to the growth, which you are up to, right? But there are also loop corrections to these two-point functions which grow.
I agree with you.
When I was saying about multiple point functions, I meant a bit different. I meant I had in mind that not the three-level three-point function grows, but for example, loop correction to the three-point function starts to grow similarly to the loop corrections to the two-point function. That's what
For single field inflation, for the variable called zeta in single field inflation, I think they cancel, and they're absent in the final
answer.
But they're zero. If you do zeta k, there is no term that goes like this.
In the loop, you calculate,
but there are many loops.
Let's take phi³ triangle diagram with three external legs.
No, but that's...
I declare that it grows.
What you are talking about is a spectator field in the Zeta space. Or
well, it doesn't matter. I'm talking about phi³ series, like just to make my point clear. Like, for example,
but this is important. That's the whole... I'm stressing this because I think it is very important to stress the difference. In the case of Zeta, there are in the single field inflation, there are particular extra symmetries that help. It's a very particular theory, that one, which has extra symmetries that make all these effects count.
Well, I'm talking about rigid de Sitter space lambda phi³ theory without any extra fields. Diagram with three legs, massless field, will start to grow.
On this, I agree. As I told you before, I agree on this.
Okay.
In the initial slide, when you discussed, we were talking about the inflaton, okay, which is a different.
Yeah, but when you do resummation, you have to take care of this fact also.
I will. Yeah, that's what we are talking about here.
Okay, let's see.
That's what we're talking about in the talk. Instead, at the beginning, one of the first few slides, we are talking about the inflaton. And the inflaton, in a sense, we're never in the Zeta space. Okay, so it's two different theories. Now, but this theory is also, if you want, is additional fields in inflation or fields in the Zeta space. And that's what we're talking about, on which I fully agree that the theory is non-perturbative. But the wave function can be computed. Because it can be proven, we discussed this wave function, the structure, and therefore we can infer that this is the following structure for the wave function, which, as you will see, is in a sense perturbative. So there is the exponent of the wave function. It has some parts which are phi square. There is if there is a mass that is same like this, then there is the phase and the k³ that I showed before, and then the logarithmic proportional to lambda. Then there is a contribution factor to the four that what we looked for before, we found before, i/(eta³) plus real and imaginary part corrections, but that are proportional to k³, so are very subleading in long distances, And they are affecting both the real and the imaginary part. But the real part doesn't have a 1 over eta cube. And then you can see this k cube log k eta, and then some lambda log to the L. And then there is other powers of phi to the 6, but they come with lambda square. And again, there is 1 over eta cube, and the real part and correction starting with k cube. So there are two things to notice of this expression that are useful. So this is the same structure before. And in order to establish that this actually is in some sense, this expression can be treated perturbatively, we need to know if this expression is perturbative or not, depend on the size of the fluctuations. But the size of the field values, the typical size of the field values, is the typical size that the correlation functions have, which we don't know how to compute the correlation function. So here we're going to assume a typical size of the correlation function. That is, we assume a typical size of the field fluctuations. And assuming this, we will show that the Banach-Davis vacuum, the wave function in this assuming the scaling of the fields is perturbative, and then we will solve self-consistency, the equation of motion, or the density matrix, compute this correlation function, and find that indeed this is the right scaling. So that's the logic. And this the scaling that we assume is the one that I mentioned before in expected by equilibration. We're assuming that the power of the fields phi goes like 1 over lambda to the 1/4, and here is the Fourier transform. And in Fourier space, there will be a decay. This, I think, should be lambda to the 1/4, and this means that the log also decays. And this is, as I said, we can use or not the wave function, we can use it, but depends if it's useful or not, depends on the size of the fluctuations, and therefore depends on what we use the wave function for. Okay, notice that if you assume this scaling, then all this power law here are hierarchically distributed in a square root of lambda, but we have to check about the logs. And here it's very important that the logs are not big. Notice that if the log were as big as square root of lambda, this would be already a problem because there are more logs in the higher powers field of phi than in a, so there is one more log per each powers of phi. So if this log were over the square root of lambda, there would be no hierarchy. If this log was over the 1 over square root of lambda, there would be no hierarchy in the wave function. But crucially, the wave function always has this k cube. And so whenever we compute the momentum operator applied to the wave function, the contribution of the log is always proportional to k cube. And one can see that it's actually the same k cube that enters in the log is the one, the same k that enters in the log is the one that is in front. For example, the lowest k is always the same k. So in the momentum, if you took all the long wavelength fluctuations of the momentum, these logs will always be proportional to k log cube, and that also will be proportional to k log cube. And so this goes like, and k log is of order this, at best, is of order the cutoff of the long distance theory, which is epsilon. And so these logs goes like epsilon cube log epsilon, and they don't go like 1 over square root of lambda. And therefore, this wave function is hierarchically structured in powers of square root of lambda. Notice that if it depends really on what we compute, because if you computed the perturbatively phi, then the phase cancels, and the 2-point function is this, and therefore the k cube inside the multiplying the log would cancel in these vertices when we use the free theory propagator, and the log would go like 1 over square root of lambda, which is much bigger than 1. And therefore the result will be non-perturbative because all these vertices will contribute all the same. But in our construction, so this is the crucial difference. And in our construction, however, we are gonna just compute the momentum applied to the wave function. Okay, now this is the technical proof, but I think I am a bit slow, but maybe let me try to give a hint of the proof. One can show that this is the structure by studying the generic diagram. And one can work in physical coordinates that are the moving coordinate over in physical momenta, the moving coordinate over the scale factor. And in such a way that in this case, all the integrals over momentum in these very complicated loop diagrams are all cut off at the same physical scale, but in a time independent way, because the cutoff is the same for everybody.
But and therefore, Leonardo, this cutoff is fixed in the same slice, like in the, for how
yes. is this? Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, I was trying to skip this technical point, but indeed you're right. So for consistency, one should take the cutoff at the earliest possible to be fixed at the earliest possible time. The scale factor is the earliest possible time of the vertices, so that there is no momentum in all this diagram that was it can exist in some loop and not it couldn't exist at format one. So we take the earliest possible slice. And because of this, now all the momentum integral are time independent, they can be carried out. It can be done last. And then we need to observe simply first the time integrals. There is no associated time dependence with the momentum integral. And simply special on the propagator, which I told is very nice. They're very nice. They told that this the bulk to boundary propagator is less than one. And the bulk to bulk propagator between some early time n and the later time m is actually bounded by the later time cube. And therefore one can expect the general series of integral in a generic diagram and show that at most this diagram goes like 1 over theta cube with an I in front, I can keep track of the I, and there is never a log appearing. And the only way to make a log appear is to consider some solidity correction here associated to the Wien number, but the Wien number is e to the k eta, and so if we terror expand e to the k eta, for example, introducing k cube eta cube, an integral 1 over eta to the fourth times k cube eta cube will give a log. But this shows us that the log are always associated, they're cut off by the exponential, so they go like log of k eta, but the k in front of the log is also the k that cut off the integral, so this structure is preserved. So this is a brief hint of this proof.
Eta is negative?
Yes.
So log
this is log of minus k eta, or is log k eta plus I, for brevity I didn't put the minus to keep the yes, that's what you're asking, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, sorry, I apologize, the log is real and so it should be log k minus k eta. I apologize for this typo. Okay. So whatever, when I said the real and the imaginary was you see here I had the minus, indeed.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now this tells us that the wave function we can apply. So let's go back to solving for the density equation. Now we can see that the wave function, we can apply the momentum operator to the wave function. So we established before, just now, that we can compute let's go back to the solving this equation. And we established that for the Bachelet's vacuum, we can compute perturbatively this wave function in such a way that if we compute the momentum is fine. But now we need a way to compute the full path integral to get to 555. So our strategy would be to find an equation not directly for this, but for the n location distribution. So how we do it? As I mentioned before, we separate the modes into short and long. The short modes are perturbative, okay? Because we can do normal perturbation theory we described before. So we introduce a window function, which is one for separating long and short modes, one for long modes and zero for short modes. Now, for technical reason, we need to keep the wave function, the window function sufficiently smooth, because we would like the long theory for intuitive reason to be local in space. And if we define the theory with a sharp cutoff in Fourier space, just to be clear, one second. So we have this window function, we define the log mode, the ones multiplied by W and omega, and one and the short mode, the one multiplied by one minus W. However, there is this the window function, we take it to be smooth, because you see that the log mode are defined with the window function. And if there was a sharp cutoff in Fourier space, the resulting theory in the log mode would be non-local. Now, this is not a tragedy. In fact, as a check of our calculation, we also do the calculation in this in the theory with the shared window function. The theory is non-local, but can be for technical reason it can be still be treated, because I remind you that the talking between different points between points in the city space is very limited in the city space, and so one can do it and we find the same result. Okay, but in order to develop some intuition here, I will take this smooth window function. And then the width of this distribution is such that it's much thinner than the correction. There will be corrections, and so it's much smaller than the correction square root of lambda, but big enough so that the theory is local, and this is the parameter controlling locality. Now, for shared models, I can do perturbation theory. So what I really would like to do is to write down a distribution function for the long mode. Indeed, I have a hope to use locality only for the long mode, not for the short modes, right? The short modes are like, even very short are in Minkowski. Their interactions are highly non-local. But the long mode maybe are local. And so that is defined, the density matrix of the long mode, which is this path integral keeping a certain fixed configuration of the long mode. This delta function ensures that the long mode are not being integrated over. This is the effective, so we have the effective probability distribution of the long modes. Okay, and now we want to try to find its equation of motion, okay? And that's where the locality should enter, because we're talking just about long modes. So the equation of motion, we follow our nose. We take the time derivative with respect of this expression. And then notice that this delta function keeps the long modes fixed. And when we take the time derivative, the time derivative has on two parts. One is the cutoff of this window function, because remember that the cutoff here is epsilon AOT lambda, a physical scale lambda. That is, epsilon AOT H. So it is, it changes the moving distance in the moving coordinate because it's constant in physical distances. So there is a time factor here, and when we take the time derivative and hit on the time dependence here, we will obtain a diffusion contribution. Because signaling the fact that some modes are transienting from long to short, from short to long, they're entering the long theory, and this appears like a diffusion term in the equation. And then there is also a drift term coming when the time derivative acts directly on the full distribution. So let's follow in our eyes what each term contributes. So let's start with the drift. So the time derivative acts only on this term, for which we can use our former equation of motion. Which is the divergence of the current. Okay, now this is a slightly complicated formula, but I will just guide you over what it matters. What needs to be seen. Remember that the time derivative of the density of the distribution was the divergence of this current. Now there is a delta. All fields are integrated, keeping the long mode fixed. So we can integrate bypass this derivative, and let it act not on the exchange derivative of phi with derivative of phi l. Carrying on some trivial factor. So this becomes an important factor. So this becomes the derivative respect to the long mode. And now there is a path integral remaining where there is no derivative anymore here, and we have this. This term here is nothing but the momentum operator acting on the wave function. And as I explained before, when we act on the derivative of the wave function, we can look at what is the wave function is and substitute with the momentum of field, with the powers of fields given but a polynomial of fields acting on the wave function. So this can be trusted, this operation. And we can define pi to be actually the action of the momentum operator on phi to be a multiplication of phi over psi. This is just some derivatives. And now, once we take this derivative, these two recombine simply in rho bar. And then we have we have to do the last path integral. So this becomes rho bar. And the last path integral is nothing but the expectation value of this operator pi by keeping the long mode fixed, the long modes fixed. And so by construction is nothing but the expectation value of this operator over the short modes, that is keeping the long mode fixed, times the probability density to have a certain long mode configuration. Okay, so in this way now, you see we have been able to find the drift term to be equal to a derivative respect to the long mode, this expectation value of an operator times the density matrix of the long mode. And the idea is that this expectation value should be taken, but this expectation value has the short mode fixed, the long mode fixed, sorry. It's only taken with respect to the short modes. And we know that perturbation theory works for them. The only thing I didn't work out explicitly for you so far is that I didn't work out explicitly how, well, I skipped some steps, but we still don't know what this function of phi is explicitly. But remember that we proved that this can be trusted, and later we will give you the explicit expression. And then, but before doing the explicit expression, I want to give you the other contribution to the equation of motion, which is the diffusion. The diffusion is the following. That is the diffusion is when the time derivative x on the window function. Okay, so there will be the derivative on x and the window function. This requires a few careful manipulation because the window function, the delta function is a bit singular. I will skip some of the steps, but basically the time one has to do a careful Taylor expansion. The time derivative really acts on this, and one has to apply the chain rule, but done in a careful way. First, we replace the derivative with respect to phi, and then take the derivative. And notice that the window function here had, was one for very long modes, zero for very short modes, and there was a time-dependent intermediate region. The intermediate region was translating in Fourier space. So the time derivative acts only on this part. The function becomes the time derivative. It's actually many derivatives. The derivative with respect to phi long times the time derivative of this delta phi. Well, the time derivative delta phi was given by is the integral over all the modes in the window in the intermediate region of the window function. These are the modes that are going in a given interval of time, passing from the short theory to the long theory. And since this window function is smooth, there is a interval of mode, a very thin interval, because this delta parameter is very thin, but there is a not zero wave thickness interval where modes can pass from short to long. And a careful treatment shows that one should also take one derivative. There is also a contribution with two derivatives respect to phi times one derivative acting on delta phi and the factor of delta phi itself. And in principle, there are also many other terms, but it has not that also pressed by explicit powers of delta, which remember is the thickness of this distribution. We take it to be very small. In principle, they can be computed. We show how to compute them, but we don't here for the talk, which is already very long. So you see that this derivative respect to phi long, and so can be brought out. And then we have the path integral of the density of the probability distribution times a principle an operator times the delta function. Sorry, there's some noise from my kid and wife. So there is is the path integral of the distribution of the modes p times the delta function, which says that keep the long mode fixed, of an operator. And this is nothing but the expectation value of the operators, of the operator keeping the long fix, times the probability distribution of the long modes. So you see we obtain two terms, one first derivative of this operator and then the second derivative on this operator. So to summarize, notice that so far in the discussion, I really did not expand in lambda. And therefore we obtain an equation of motion valid at an order in lambda and all orders in epsilon, which is the size of the gradient terms, but simply neglecting these delta corrections, we have obtained a Fokker-Planck-like equations, which has a drift and a diffusion term for the long wavelength distribution. There is a drift term, which is the total derivative of the distribution. Sorry, I apologize that I have a typo. Rho is the same as p bar, okay? I apologize. Rho long is the same as p bar. I apologize for the typo. So there is a drift term and a sort of diffusion term, but the diffusion term has some of two terms, the first derivative and the second derivative. Now we want to solve this equation, and the strategy will be to compute, we can compute this expectation value in perturbation theories because we can.
So, Leonardo, you want to solve this equation analytically, order by order?
Yes, order by order in which sense? I want to solve it. I didn't say yet order by order because It's unclear yet what is the expansion parameter.
Okay. Right?
Yes. Yeah. We want to solve it in a sense non-perturbatively.
Okay.
But notice that these expectation values are always with respect to the Schur modes. And so we can take ordinary perturbation theory to compute them because it's an expansion in powers of lambda, log epsilon. And you will see, in reality, since the Schur modes, the long modes are very big, because remember, the long modes goes like, we expect to go like 1/√λ.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry, 1/λ^1/4. Actually, this is another perturbation theory, is an expansion in powers of √λ/ε, which is still smaller than one.
Mm-hmm.
So we obtain, then once we take the expectation values, we have, in principle, a closed equation for the long modes. It's a function only of the long modes, and in principle can be solved. Okay, so let's do this step, these steps. First, I need to finally to say what is this momentum. This is very simple to do. In fact, it was already done, at least a leading order, but we just needed to compute some leading order contributions. But the wave functions actually goes like this, a leading order. It is, I already showed what is the leading answer. Is this lambda phi to the fourth, a leading order in epsilon. So remember that the phase didn't have any k cube, but the real part had the k cube. So a leading order in eta, a cube is nothing but 1/eta³. So a leading order in eta, it's just an imaginary part, and there is lambda phi to the fourth and lambda square phi to the sixth, in such a way that the momentum is the standard Rolle solution for the long mode. And then there is a subleading corrections together with other that we will discuss. And these subleading corrections for the long mode is smaller than this one, because the long mode are 1/λ^1/4. So this is smaller than this by actually √λ. So this is negligible, a leading order, and this is the leading answer. Plus also correction proportional to k eta, which is a word epsilon. So pi of phi, at least we know in principle how to compute it to arbitrary order, and one can start at first order. So first order in √λ and see if there is an expansion in √λ. But I'm not assuming yes so far. So in principle we have this term here, okay? And now we want to solve for it. We need to compute these expectation values, right? Okay, because here in this slide, I simply apply the momentum to wave function and define what is the function that results in multiplying the momentum. This is the function, but I didn't yet take the expectation value. So here there is a function phi, I know what it is, and I need to take these expectation values. Now, I can take this expectation value in principle, they give me some expression, then I can solve this equation. But this equation, it's, I believe, impossible to solve. It's still very hard because it's still a functional equation, okay? But how it can be simpler to solve? Because different points don't talk to each other in the city space. And these are all long points. So different long points, different Hubble patches don't talk to each other. So we want to solve it by defining a certain number of, solving it, keeping only a certain number of locations. For a given number of locations that we keep, we can compute n correlation functions involving n fields. So the way we are going to solve for the system is that first we have to do some work given the number of legs, axes at which we want to compute correlation function. So instead of expanding in the number of fields we have in the correlation function, we expand in the number of locations. So it's the opposite of what we normally do in Minkowski, at least different, but there is still an expansion, okay? And the simplest way to start is to start with the one location, that is compute correlation functions of fields at the same location. This is controlled for the long fluctuations of doing to the distribution, probability distribution, of the to have a certain value of phi called phi one at position x one, which is given by integrating over all the possible locations, keeping the location x one fixed. Now, one can trivially apply the time derivative here and do some algebra manipulation, and it shouldn't be a surprise. It's not so much a surprise that this probability distribution Fokker's another Fokker-Planck equation. But this function is a one variable, so is a partial differential equation. It's not a functional equation. So it's not a functional Fokker-Planck equation. It's a partial differential equation. It's what normally is called Fokker-Planck equation in two variable time and the location phi one. And there is a diffusion term given by the time derivative delta phi square and a drift term. Notice that I neglected the one derivative term. There was another tadpole part in the diffusion. And this I neglect because As you will see, we have some scaling in mind. We have in mind that the fields goes like 1/√ of lambda to the 1/4. And so we can estimate how much is the various terms contribute. The short modes are still perturbative because they are short. Perturbation theory holds, so they're sizable, they're Hubble. And the long mode, we have an estimate, it goes like h over lambda to the 1/4. And we assume this, and we will prove at the end that this is correct, making everything self-consistent, but it is not yet, it is not so, yet.
Leonardo, yes. One question, just why you have chosen this localized probability distribution, like delta?
Because now, this delta function allows me to write down what is the definition of the probability distribution of the field values at location x1, no matter what the other the field the other location does.
Okay. So is that
this is help
you to compute?
This will allow me to compute the expectation value of phi of x1 to the n.
So
we can do this for multiple locations. I start with the simplest one, which is one location, so I can compute phi of x1 to the n. And this makes, it's useful because makes the functional differential equation a partial differential equation.
Okay.
And notice that since the theory was, the window function was smooth, these expectation values should be done in the background of the long mode. But since the window function was smooth, the Fetti theory is actually local in space. And so they depend, these are expectation values of the short modes. And they care only of the field value at the same location, which is phi one. They don't care of the long field at the different location. So it's actually depends on the field value at the location where these operators are evaluated. Now we have a partial differential equation and we can compute the expectation value of the short modes on this way. They compute with ordinary perturbation theory. So there are two contributions. This delta phi square is the two-point function of the short modes integrated over some window function in Fourier space. And the two-point function of the short modes in Fourier space,
so, it just that window function is used to smooth the two-point function, I think.
It's, yeah, but what enters here, correct, but what enters here, it's only the window function between the integral of the mode between on the transition region of the window function. Remember, the window function was 1 up to lambda and then 0 beyond 1 plus delta lambda. Okay. And was smooth in this regime. And so we're interested only in is a thin shallow modes.
Okay.
But it's not arbitrarily thin because then the theory becomes non-local. But so in each for each mode in the shell modes are perturbed, so it goes like h over k cube, and there are corrections. Given in the long mode it goes like in this power, then they are over the square root of lambda. So they can be dropped in the first approximation. And pi, again, the expectation of the fields can be seen that the leading end term is this one, the classical one, plus correction for the square root of lambda. Now we plug back this term here, take trivial derivatives, and we obtain an equation which is closed only for the field, the long field at one location, phi one. And this equation is wrong by square root of lambda terms that are neglected, by delta, which are the smoothing, the thickness of the window function, and epsilon, which is the size of the long wavelength, the shortest gradients in the long wavelength theory. And which in principle, they all can be computed. And this gamma is an operator, which is a drift term and a diffusion term. This is nothing but the famous Sarovsky equation. But now it has been rigorously derived in the sense that we have control on the approximation we made. And in principle, we can include them. In fact, I will show you a couple that we'll include. And I'll try to, I mean, I think the most important part of the story has been told. Now I will present you a couple of solutions. First of all, I can, so we'll not go too much over time, even though I was told that it's flexible. So maybe, but I will not go too much beyond. So now there is an equation. In principle, so
I'm just asking one thing. So this correction term, is it perturbatively small or you can like?
Yeah, because you see all these terms are less than one. Epsilon is much less than one, delta is much less than one, and square root of lambda is much less than one. So these terms are perturbative small, that's why it can be dropped.
Okay.
And they're all, one can estimate all of them. And maybe I will show you some of them later, but delta and epsilon are small by construction.
Do you have any numerical estimate for how small it is?
Yeah, you will see, for example, the leading correction square root of lambda, we will, I will show you explicitly.
Okay. Thank you.
I mean, and then this delta and epsilon can be made as small as e to the one over square root of lambda, but I don't, so the parametrics is that these terms, delta and epsilon, can be made of order e to the minus one over square root of lambda, so incredibly smaller than square root of lambda. Okay. But I think the only numerical factor that remains is the prefactor in front of these corrections.
Okay.
Now, let's try to solve this equation. For example, it can be argued that the solution to the Bachelet's vacuum is actually given by the equilibrium solution. So let's look for if there is an equilibrium solution, a time-independent solution. Let's put this to zero and try to solve it. And there is an equilibrium solution, which goes like e to the minus lambda phi long to the fourth, phi one to the fourth over h to the fourth. So this is a very important result for us because it shows that the size of the fluctuation is indeed of order one over lambda to the one quarter, which was the scaling we assumed from the beginning. So the phi counting is correct, and this shows that all our results are self-consistent. Otherwise it wouldn't be consistent, but indeed it's consistent. The perturbation theory holds for the Charmeaux up to powers of square root of lambda. The wave function can be computed perturbatively in powers of square root of lambda. It also can be shown that the time dependence but notice this is a very, very non-perturbative result. This in a sense is some moment of the wave function of the system, of the vacuum wave function of the system. And it is very non-perturbative. It is the field values over lambda, one over lambda to one quarter. And notice that it is not Gaussian, it is lambda phi to a fourth. So this non-perturbative treatment of the solution is of lambda does not correspond to an effective mass, because an effective mass would be a Gaussian wave function, because if it was an effective mass, there would be only Gaussian, the distribution would be Gaussian, instead it's not Gaussian at all, okay? It's very different from a Gaussian, but it's still peaked, and it's still, therefore, the correlation functions are not arbitrarily large. And in particular, one can show that the time dependent solution decay, because one can look at the eigenvalues of this differential operator, and the eigenvalues actually show that the solution decays. And this suggests that the system is stable and an attractor is the solution, which I will show more rigorously later. Sayanda just asked but what about the sub-leading corrections? I mean, indeed, the whole point was to show what are the sub-leading corrections to show that we can compute it. It's a simple exercise at this point to include the sub-leading corrections. We need to take these expectation values in perturbation theory, including the sub-leading corrections. The counting we know now what it is phi short is about the Hubble because it's perturbative, and phi long is about the h over lambda to the one quarter. So we look back to the Feynman rules and consider all the terms which are first corrections in lambda. It does not, by parity in phi, the first correction are worth the square root of lambda. So we compute the momentum. The momentum has two corrections. This is the one, the classical one we had before. Then there are the correction when all the modes are long. This is the one that goes like lambda phi to the fifth. And then this is very simply to understand, is the sub-leading correction to the slow solution for an homogeneous mode in lambda phi to the fourth in the Sitter space. And this part is the fact that as the long mode move, since there is lambda phi to the fourth, the shell modes do something and they act like a mass of order Hubble to the long mode. And so this is the slow solution for a field with mass of order phi short square. Vice versa, this is what I say. The mass is actually over the Hubble square times log epsilon, because the correlation function of the Charmeaux modes grows, is one over k cube and needs to be integrated in k. Then we also compute the sub-leading order, the diffusion term. And this is also interesting because this is the leading order, one over k cube from before. But now the modes, the Charmeaux modes, live in the background of the long mode. You see this expectation value as the background. And because of lambda phi to the fourth, the long mode give a mass to the short, And this mass is of order lambda phi, phi square. And this lambda, since phi square is of order 1 over square root of lambda, this is another square root of lambda correction. So these are all free square root of lambda correction. Then we plug them back here. And you see that these terms now are lambda correction. This is the effective mass to the drift of the long mode, for example. But notice that there are these log epsilon. Log epsilon is our arbitrary cutoff that we inserted a time somewhere below Hubble. But and it's not a physical quantity, it's our choice. So physical quantity should not depend on log epsilon. And it's quite, at the moment, disturbing that there is a log epsilon here. But let's go on. Now, this equation with this plugin, we can solve it. And this is the solution. It can be solved perturbatively because these are corrections of order square root of lambda. These are corrections of order square root of lambda. So they can be solved perturbatively. And then once we have the solution, we can compute the n phi of x1 to the n, phi long to the x1 to the n, as the integral, as a single ordinary integral times this. And that depends, this depends on log epsilon, obviously, because this solution depends on log epsilon. And therefore, it's wrong, it's unphysical. Actually, the solution we think is right, but it's okay to get an unphysical result for the long fluctuation because phi long to the x is defined by us, is an epsilon dependent definition. It's not a natural, it's not a definition chosen by nature. And the physical is not a physical definition. The physical definition, the physical field is actually the full phi of x, which is the sum of the short and the long modes. That's the full field. And notice that if I compute all these log epsilon appear at order square root of lambda, but phi short is of order phi long times lambda to the 1/4. So phi short square is of order square root of lambda times phi long square. So if I look at the square root of lambda corrections, I should expect the corrections also from computing the phi short modes. And indeed, I should do at least, in this phi of x to the n, there should be phi long of x to the n, plus I should include phi short square, phi long of x to the n minus 2. This is also a contribution from square root of order square root of lambda. When we do this, we obtain the following result. So the log epsilon cancelled. Okay, the full result doesn't have log epsilon. There is a leading order result, which is 1 over square root of lambda to the 2n, as expected. 1 over lambda to 1/4 to the 2n, which is 1 over square root of lambda. I mean, okay, it goes like the long mode like a square root of lambda. This is the leading answer. But then there is a square root of lambda correction. With this is the prefactor, and you this is the numerics of the prefactor. And then there is an order lambda correction that we neglected, and we know what we neglected.
So, Leonardo. So, to the power 2n means you want to point some even point correlation functions, kind of that?
Because the order canceled by parity.
Because
the wave function is still, you see that the wave function was still phi minus phi. Parity meaning phi minus phi symmetric, so they're all just automatically zero.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is for one location. But you see that the fact that log epsilon cancel is an important consistency check, and now we have a result that in principle have the corrections and we can compute to arbitrary order and precision. In principle, also the epsilon and the delta corrections can be included. Let me, in the 5 minutes, highlight the other results. What about one location? What about the two locations? If you want to compute phi of x1, phi of x2.
So, okay. Leonardo.
Yes.
So, for the validity of your formulation, do we have to take a late time limit or not? Because the boundary picture seems to be taking future infinity, but we are solving dynamics.
Yeah, you're right. But also, a finite time, so there is parity. That is all the, you can always start, if you start with a state which is, you can start with a state that is a non-parity even, and then you will get some non-parity initial, condition. But let's say in principle, you can have some non-parity even contribution if you start from these states, but these states decay with time. Thank you for your question. But decay with time, and this is the asymptotic solution. I simply presented the asymptotic solution. But those parts can be included also. but dedicate with time. So what about two locations? This, I think, is interesting. I would like to explain briefly two locations, because we can, again, similar in the construction, find the evolution of the distribution for two locations, phi at x1 and phi of x2. Clearly, it must depend only on delta x. And this solves the following differential equation. There is two, there are two operators acting on phi one, differential operator for phi one and phi two. These are the same operator we found for the evolution of the one-point distribution, one-location distribution. But there is also this Bessel function acting on which connects the two locations, and this Bessel function is a function of time. And this is a very intuitive, because this Bessel function is one exactly time.
Sorry, Leonardo, one more. Sorry. Here in this plot, in this crossing region, the T is the usual time scale or conformal time scale?
Yeah, let me explain this picture. Yeah, exactly. I was going to explain this picture. One second. And I moved the slide, but then I needed to come back. Yeah, exactly. Let me explain this picture. This is the Bessel function as a function of time, which is here. So a late time, you see this is zero, which tells us that the two points, this is a very small interaction at late time, because it's very small. But at early time, this is a very big interaction. And then there is a transition region, and the Bessel function to decay by order one, it takes an ample time, okay? It takes an ample time, because the time scale here, it's Hubble, okay? That's what I mean, to change. This crossing region happens more or less when the modes, when a given mode goes from short to long, is located at values of the physical distance, which is equal to the cutoff. But the time it takes to cross it is Hubble scale.
Okay.
Let me know if I didn't answer your question. Okay, but good.
This crossing, is it very smooth from this?
It's very smooth, right? It's crossing smooth in the sense that this interaction as a function of time is this Bessel function, which is very smooth. However, importantly, I'm going to explain this next. It is fast with respect to the time scale of the system. Let me explain this.
Okay.
So there is two intuitive aspects and one useful aspect of this picture, which I'm going to highlight. Now, the fact that the time and this interaction is zero means that the long distance is the two points interact independent. It is a late time indeed, the solution, since there is no connection. The solution is the generic solution at one location and the generic solution at the second location. So it's intuitive, it should behave like this. At early times, it's also important this goes to one, because when this goes to one, this is a big interaction. And it is so big that it ensures that the solution is this is a solution. The solution of the two locations is that the fields are the same, have the same value, times a solution for one location, okay? Which is very important. In particular, we'll choose the equilibrium solution, the one time independent, because in this way, you expect that these two points very early on are within the same cutoff, a very short distance, but this is just the long theory, and there is no short wavelength gradient in the long theory, so they should be the same, should have the same value. And consistently, this works. And now, your question about the time scale, because
can you more explain why you have chosen the equilibrium p value? I'm not getting this
here.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, this is a bit for simplicity. I mean, given that I will not have time to show it more in detail, but this equilibrium distribution is an attractor, okay? If you start from some state defined somewhat close, but quite broadly close, in a broad way, but close to the Banach-Davis vacuum, then the correlation function will approach the one on the Banach-Davis vacuum. And this is an equilibrium distribution is the correlation function of the Banach-Davis vacuum.
Okay.
So it's particularly useful, but I didn't need to choose that. I could have chosen another one.
Okay.
But it's useful, this one. Okay, now in terms of time scales, notice that the crossing time is Hubble time, but the time scale is controlled, or the system is controlled by the eigenvalues of this operator, which one can see they go like 1/√λ. So in a sense, the time scale of crossing is much faster than the time scale of the normal evolution of the distribution, which is √λ. And therefore, this is a very, very fast transition. And therefore, we know we remember from undergraduate quantum mechanics how to solve when there are fast transition. Maybe I forgot, but then I relearned it again. Is we can do sudden perturbation theory. When an interaction changes rapidly with respect to the solution of the problem when interaction is zero, then we can do sudden perturbation theory. We have an exact solution in this regime. We have a generic solution in this regime. Exact also, we can solve square root of lambda. And notice that the parameter is the same, square root of lambda, but that's a coincidence a bit. The parameter that controls the sudden perturbation theory that can be made arbitrary correct is square root of lambda. And now let me highlight a few results. Then we can solve for it and we can compute correlation functions. And we can find that these correlation functions are functions only of Z, where Z is the De Sitter invariant distance. So this means that the new vacuum state that we found, which is, we call it Banach-Davis vacuum, but it's non-perturbatively different than the free theory Banach-Davis vacuum. It's a new state, but share the property that a shared wavelength, the fields are in the perturbative theory, but the long wavelength are completely different. And, but it's still the De Sitter invariant. That is, the De Sitter symmetry is not spontaneously broken, okay? There is a new invariant vacuum. And notice that a long distance is this correlation function decays like square root of lambda, like distance to the square root of lambda. So it's non-perturbative, but it means that the system is stable, okay? This signal stability. And in particular, a fixed commoving distances, the late time behavior of, if you conclude also the time dependence, this endpoint and location correlation function goes like the product of single point location distribution expectation values, all computed in equilibrium distribution. And also it shows that the theory the power country is the one we assume, so everything is still consistent. Since it was asked, let me spend 1 minute on state independence. All the results so far have been obtained using this Banach-Davis wave function, which was important for the initial condition, the Schur modes. But we can define other states which are obtained in the path integral inserting some states and some times, and then taking in the infinite path the Banach-Davis boundary condition. So these are perturbations. These are not probably the most generic state, even though they're very, very generic. They're all the ones that can be reached by Banach-Davis upon arbitrary insertion of operators. Now, then one can see the correlation functions in this state can be seen as taking higher points correlation functions in the Banach-Davis vacuum by including this operator here as intermediate states. And the fact that these correlation functions decay in time means that all the correlation functions in this state will also approach the one of the computing the Banach-Davis vacuum. That is, a late time, this correlation function, as we make the time of observation much longer than the time where we insert in this state, that is, we start in the infinite past, in very, very far past, with a different state than the Banach-Davis vacuum, then the correlation function approaches the one of the Banach-Davis vacuum that I computed before. So the Banach-Davis vacuum is an attractor. Okay, there is also another way to consider that there is Banach-Davis vacuum an attractor. I can consider to add to the wave function an arbitrary phase of order one. So to be very, for example, for the Slorod solution of the long wavelength fields, I can take a very, very different velocity, very, very different. One studies the equation of motion and find that actually the phase, I'm running really out of time. So the phase actually decays very fast. The last result I want to show is that if we restrict to the static patch, the correlation function we computed in all the Poincaré patch, but in the static patch, the gray region, they should be thermal. Thermal correlation function satisfy a certain periodicity of in imaginary time. It's called the KMS condition. And it's interesting in our setting because checking this condition amounts to checking contribution different order in square root of lambda. And we did check them, so, and we found that
due to this KMS condition, all the odd point function will be zero also. KMS condition basically tells you about time translational symmetry, T plus I beta. If you do that, beta means this TDS inverse is your beta.
Yeah, because I think when we do static patch and we say thermal, we're really meaning the batch in the batch that is bad.
Yeah,
I agree with that. Yeah, it must be so. Thank you for interesting point. Thank you. And okay, so I really have no time, so let me skip. I'm really half an hour, half beyond time. So let me conclude. But
I'm very happy that you are discussing so many things. I'm really enjoying your talk. That's why asking a lot of questions.
That's perfect. I had fun. So, okay, this is the summary. Thank you very much for the invitation. So, we derived a formalism to compute correlation function lambda to the fourth in the city space, which is a manifest expansion in many parameters all less than one. The width of the window function, epsilon, the size of the gradients, n square root of lambda, the size of the long gradients, which is a small mistake. And the solution is remarkably non-perturbative, but we can solve for it. We find that there's an equilibrium solution, and the stability, this correlation function approach a time-independent one. And it's also, they are quite independent of the state once in a suitable neighborhood, broad neighborhood of the Bunch-Lippe-Zwack. That is, the correlation function in any state approach the one in the equilibrium state at late enough time. And the state has the Sitter invariant and is also thermal in the static patch. I think this addresses the issues of stability and how to solve correlation functions in a quantum level in inflation, but this has been done for lambda only in the rigid limit. And it's an interesting question to go beyond the gravitational rigid limit. Okay, thank you for the time. That's all.
So we have to clap for Leonardo for giving such an interesting and detailed talk. We have enjoyed a lot. Hopefully everyone enjoyed. So we have to give a clap.
Thank you.
So yeah, guys, you can ask any question you have. Please ask. Leonardo is available. Please ask.
Sorry, can I ask a quick question, Leonardo? Do you have any thoughts on how to incorporate weakly dynamical gravity? Maybe you could see some hints of the reheating surface becoming highly curved or something like that.
Yes. I think we can include them. It's a bit. Yes, I mean, I have already. We have estimates and some ideas, but. We don't think it's a big complication. However, it's all intuitively the field goes up, and when it goes up, there is a bit more expansion of the universe, and by the time it comes down, it produces a bit more volume. Okay, I cannot explain now by too many words. I mean, then there is a technical steps of how to make these rigorous, but I think. It's possible to do it because we are still at double scales, much less than Planck. But this is the intuition. The intuition should be that sometimes the field goes up and the universe expands a bit more. And this is the fact we can include. But this is a very small effect, so it can be done practically.
Another question, do you have some result on the four-point function? Because even if it's the Sitter invariant, you start to have more structure there, more possibilities.
Yeah, very, very, that would be nice, yeah. I mean, in reality, these were computed, these are, you see, are n plus m correlation functions, are n plus m, and they're with, yeah, so, yeah, I think we know the leading behavior of actually. We have many endpoint functions at two locations, arbitrary large, but only two locations. You were asking maybe four locations.
That's right.
But,
yeah.
Yeah. In fact, I thought. Oh yeah, but this is we have it. No. Yeah, for location. No, it's a bit more work. I didn't study. Yes, but it can be done. I mean, it's not. I mean, we have some general expression. I think we have some general expression, but it's a bit rough. And all the leading.
So you think it's technically doable?
Yeah, no problem. In fact, I don't remember at the end what we decided to put precisely in the paper. We have a rough expression in some kinematical regime where And so there's a particularly simple kinematic regime where there is a big hierarchy between all the momenta. This means that all the modes decouple one at a time, all the points decouple one at a time. First moment. So it should be, so take endpoints. Back in the past, they're all in the same location. So they're all one point. But then they can be spaced enough so that first one point come out and they become two independent points, then 3 points, 4 points, but all kind of hierarchically. That's particularly simple. In Fourier space, it's kind of a very hierarchically squeezed limit. And I think in that there is a simple expression, but all the leading order in square root of lambda. But all of this is, I think, is doable. How complicated it is technically, not so much. It's a bit like quantum mechanics with some variables. It's as complicated as that. So it is not zero complication, but so not infinite.
I think Yuko have one more.
Yeah, so I have a question about the last part of your talk, like attractor behavior to bunch Davis. And that yes. part sounded somehow related to this Euclidean argument by Marrow, Morrison, and so on. Like exponential fall of two. Radiative corrections and so on.
I'm not sure about this. I'm not sure because I think the Euclidean, as we discussed before, probably the Euclidean rotation is done automatically in the bunch Davis vacuum. So it's already okay. in this vacuum. Mm. So I'm not sure how to connect.
So can you interpret this attractor behavior as excited states sort of
correct.
Diluted?
Correct. So. Perfect. Yeah, exactly. You're 100%, I think.
Okay.
A few particles on top, yeah, exactly.
So this thing can also be used, can be calculated with some excited states as well?
Yeah, one can compute, for example, phi of some time here.
Mm-hmm.
And one can carry the calculation on. There are some Feynman rules. One can compute the wave function in this way using Feynman rules because they, remember, we converge and then this would represent, roughly speaking, as Yuki was saying, the decaying of a particle, the effect of some particle inserted some time and then decaying.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Now, why I'm saying, because like for interacting cases, people used to talk about alpha vacua, which is like...
No, this we cannot do this here, because I think alpha vacua are really badly defined. Sorry, I didn't want to cut you out. But that was your question. No, sorry, go on. But because the alpha vacuum are really badly defined in the past. So in the past, we need to have a well-defined vacuum. And I don't think that for interacting theory, they're not well-defined in the past. In the past, we do perturbation theory, and which you should hold. So they have a problem. I'm not trying to fix that problem.
Okay. So have you think
Thank
something
you,
about any scattering or something in this?
No, we thought about correlation functions.
Because Pimentel is here. Pimentel will give a talk on Monday regarding something like bootstrap and all.
Yeah. So in the past, this correlation function, they can become the scattering, but as we move all they pointed out that in the past, these correlation functions contain the S matrix, but I don't think here there is many surprises because in the arbitrary past, all the modes become shorts and the short modes are perturbative. So this is here, the challenge and also the field theory interest that mostly at least the zero order interest, is that this nonlinearity is built up at late time, okay, and break perturbation theory at late time. But the short times, there is nothing, a short wavelength, I don't find any, there's no problems.
Okay, anybody have other questions to ask to Leonardo? I'm not thinking nobody have. And Pimentel, you want to comment on the last issue, this S matrix, or we will talk about on Monday.
Yeah, I'll talk about it on Monday. I agree with everything Leonardo said.
Yeah, okay. So we have to thank Leonardo. It's a very nice talk. And from my side, I'm saying be safe, healthy. And I know that you are right now taking care of your child also. So many responsibilities. So, yeah.
There are difficult times for everybody. And
So
best wishes to all, guys. Thank you for attending. And best wishes.
Thank you for coming and joining this talk. And we will talk some near time. See you.
It's true. Bye-bye. Bye-bye, all.